In this last video of this lecture, I want to focus on this question. Where can an element sigma in aut L over K send an element alpha in L? So in the examples we've looked at so far, for example, in the case where L was C and R was K and K was R, we saw that an element of aut C over R was determined by where it sent the special element I. So we're asking, where can an automorphism of C fixing R send I? And we saw that because I squared equals negative one, I had to get sent to an element of C that squares to negative one. We saw something really similar when we looked at Q adjoin cube root of two over Q. We saw that an automorphism of Q adjoin cube root of two fixing Q was determined by where it sent the one special element, cube root of two. And we saw that it had to send that element to some element in Q adjoin cube root of two, where you cube it and you get two. Last one, in the case where we looked at FP adjoin U, adjoin U to the one over P as an extension of FP adjoin U, we saw that an automorphism of the bigger field fixing the smaller field was determined by where it sent the element u to the one over p. And we had to send that element to a root of the polynomial x to the p minus u. So what I'm gonna prove here is following the presentation in Conrad's notes, the Galois correspondence. I'm gonna prove theorem 2.4 and corollary 2.5. from those notes. And if you add those together, I think this gives a nicer presentation than the corresponding results in Dummett and Foote, which is proposition two in section 14.1. Okay, so what are we gonna prove? If sigma is an automorphism of L fixing K, and F of X is a polynomial in K bracket X, so coefficients in K, then sigma of F of alpha is equal to F of sigma of alpha for all alpha in L. So in particular, the case that's going to be most important to us is what happens when alpha is a root of the polynomial F. We're going to see that sigma permutes the roots of F of X in L. And the proof of this first part of the statement is just going to be to compute both sides. So let's write out f of x in terms of its coefficients. So cn x to the n plus cn minus 1 x to the n minus 1 plus 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 c1x plus c0. So let's say that cn is not 0 and all these coefficients are in k. So sigma is an element of aut L over k. So it fixes k. So sigma of ci is ci for all I. So what is sigma of f of alpha? It's sigma applied to cn alpha to the n plus cn minus 1 alpha to the n minus 1 plus 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 c1 alpha plus c0. This is an automorphism of L, so it's additive. So this is sigma of cn alpha to the n plus sigma of cn minus 1 alpha to the n minus 1 plus 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 sigma of c1 alpha plus sigma of c0. And okay, it's multiplicative as well. This is sigma of cn times sigma of alpha to the n plus sigma of cn minus 1 plus sigma of alpha to the n minus 1 plus 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 sigma of c1 times sigma of alpha plus sigma of c0. But we know sigma fixes each of these ci's, so we get cn, and then sigma of alpha to the n, well, that is sigma of alpha to the n. So we get cn, sigma of alpha to the n, plus cn minus 1, sigma of alpha to the n minus 1 plus 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 c1 sigma of alpha plus c0. And what is this? This is f of sigma of alpha. So that's it. So that's the whole proof of the first part. You just compute both sides using the fact that sigma is an automorphism of L fixing K. So now let's look at this case where f of alpha equals 0. So what do we get from applying this result? F of sigma of alpha, well, that is sigma of f of alpha, which is sigma of 0, which is 0. So sigma sends each root of f of x in L to another root of f of x in L. We started with this root alpha, and where does it send? Where does sigma send alpha? Well, all we know is that f of sigma of alpha is 0. So sigma of alpha is also a root of F. Okay, so what do we know about the set of roots of F of X in L? It's finite because F of X is a polynomial of degree N. So it has at most N roots in this field. And sigma is an automorphism of L. So it's an injective map from L to L. So in particular, you could ask, what does sigma do to these roots of F of X in L? And it's an injective map from a finite set to itself because it takes each root of F of X and sends it to another root of F of X. And it's injective. But an injective map on a finite set is automatically bijective just by counting. So if it's injective, then it also has to be surjective. So sigma is a bijective map of this finite set of roots. Another way to say that is sigma is a permutation of these roots. Okay, so I'm going to pause and erase, and I'm going to focus on the case that is most interesting that has come up already, which is what kind of polynomial is it most interesting to look at here? Well, what if you take f of x to be the minimal polynomial for some element alpha in L that's algebraic over K? So then we know that minimal polynomial is irreducible, and the elements of aut L over K, each element is going to give some permutation of the roots. Let's apply this theorem 2.4 to the special case that's most interesting to us. So Conrad gives a name for the roots of a common irreducible polynomial in K bracket X are called K conjugates. Corollary 2.5 says, let's take some sigma in aut L over K, an automorphism of L that fixes K. Sigma permutes K conjugates in L. So the proof is we're just going to apply this theorem to the irreducible polynomial of some element alpha. So to the irreducible polynomial M alpha K of X. So where does alpha get sent by an element of aut L over K? Well, it has to get sent to some other root of this minimal polynomial. But what are the roots of the minimal polynomial? Those are the K conjugates of alpha. So each element in this group of automorphisms of L fixing K sends this root of the minimal polynomial to another one of the roots of the minimal polynomial that's in L. So it gets sent to another K conjugate of alpha that's in L. So this sigma we know gives a permutation of the roots of f of x in L. And this is what we get when we apply this to the minimal polynomial of some elements of L over K. Okay, so these results are very, very useful in actually computing the group of automorphisms of L fixing a subfield K. So in the examples that we've looked at so far, where in a couple of examples we showed that this group of automorphisms was trivial, and in the case of automorphisms of C fixing the real numbers, we showed that we had this Z mod 2Z. But in all of those arguments, what it came down to saying was that an automorphism has to send some special element to some root of some polynomial. And then what we were going to do is say, well, what are the roots of that polynomial in the field L? And that's how we drew our conclusion. And what we've proven here is just a more systematic version of this result, that up until now, we've redone this argument a couple of times. And now we just know that sigma has to send the roots of the minimal polynomial of alpha over K to other roots of the minimal polynomial of alpha over K, that it gives a permutation of the set of roots. And that's gonna allow us to quickly determine, in many cases, the structure of this group aut L over K.